All right, good evening everyone, wherever are you're joining us this time. Naman, at least in the same time zone tayo. Sabi ko, bago ako bumalik sa US, I have to talk to you again about itong mga latest developments. Thank you very much, Admiral Ong, former, top official at the Philippine Navy, and of course now professor of praxis at Ateneo de Manila University. Thank you very much, Professor, ex-Admiral, for joining us.
Thank you, Richard. Good evening.
I mean, we're just going to call you Admiral kasi emeritus ka na. The same way na when we talk to Justice Scarfi, we call him Justice. But thank you so much again. So you're not in active service, just to make it clear to people. Kasi baka mamaya, di ba? Sino mayan yung... So I separately interviewed si Commodore Trinidad, right? About what's happening in the Philippine Navy in terms of active service personnel. Pero I want to talk to you, Admiral Ong, because you're one of the leading strategists in the Philippines when it comes to looking at the big defense picture, and also operational issues. Marami tayong pag-usapan. Bago natin puntahan itong mga marites diplomacy ng China, whether ito yung gentleman's agreement, new model agreement, special temporary arrangements. I know that's a little bit speculative. You may feel uncomfortable, just like how Jay Batumbacal was feeling uncomfortable to discuss ICC. Let's start with things that are, I think, more spicy and interesting, and perhaps less speculative. Let's talk about SQUAD. What is your sense about this new SQUAD? Namely, Philippines, Australia, US, and Japan. Obviously, if when it comes to quadrilaterals, ang pinakasikat dyan is the Quad of India, Australia, Japan, and the United States. And then, of course, other people are talking about also other squads or other quads. Korea naman dyan. Now, this SQUAD thing is gaining a lot of media traction. I think I already had, multiple pieces on this. And medyo I made some, serve the tea to our Indian friends, because ang basa ko dito is, I raised a question during the Munich Security Conference a few days before Russia invaded Ukraine, dun sa Quad panel, and Jai Shankar, their foreign minister, was there, and I asked them, is Quad the Asian NATO? Of course, I knew they were going to reject it, but he went on like nag-rant siya and all, that's a lazy analogy, nag-ganyan-ganyan siya. And essentially made it clear that India is there, it's an alliance of convenience. They have shared interests, so they're going to be there. But India is not a U.S. ally. India has no treaty alliance with any other power. It wants to remain independent. And of course, a few days later, when Russia invaded Ukraine, India never condemned it. India did not stand with Ukraine. India kept on going with Russia, S-400 missile defense systems. They doubled down on energy imports. At some point, India was the biggest importer of oil from Russia. So there has been a lot of tensions between India and the West, not to mention ito yung mga allegations of overseas assassination plots against Indian dissidents. So many points of tension. And then comes the Philippines. Wala na si Digong. BBM comes in. Medyo beshi. Next thing you know, naka-second squad meeting na tayo. One was last year during the Shangri-La Dialogue in Singapore, and then now you have in Hawaii this latest meeting. First of all, Admiral Ong, is the squad, is it an idea whose time has arrived? And what is your expectation management stance on this issue?
Okay, Richard, thank you for that question. Siguro, I will answer you in a long-winded way, no? Indirect. Kasi we need to, kumbaga sa mga abogado, according to yung, say, PJ, we have to lay the predicate muna before you go to the squad. Okay? Which I think, ikaw yung nag-coin ng term na yun eh. So parang, yun ngayon yung hot potato ngayon na term. Okay? Now, yung foundation yan would be yung bilaterals. Okay? Yung bilateral engagements natin with the US, with Australia, tsaka with Japan. Yun muna. I will look at yung readouts, yung result ng ating bilateral security dialogue between the Philippines and the United States. Then yung 2+2 between the Philippines and Japan. Very solid na yung foundation nun. Then we move towards yung trilateral, yung US, Japan, tsaka Philippines. Maganda rin yung grounding doon. It started off within the militaries. AFP into PAYCOM, tsaka yung Joint Self-Defense Force ng Japan, no? Then naging, I think last year, it was among the National Security Advisors. Then of course, yung pinaculmination niya would be yung Trilateral Summit in Washington, D.C. So yun yung grounding muna nun. Okay? Then yung sa Hawaii na meeting was yung squad na. Okay? May pumasok na si Australia doon sa discussion. But if we deconstruct all those bilaterals and trilaterals, may meron na rin meron siya mag meron na siyang nahubog na yung ano eh, yung laman noon. Kasi it cannot be just parang photo op lang yung apat na defense ministers nag picture taking o yung tatlo.
May groundwork na, may groundwork.
Pero na, may solid ano niya, may solid commitments na yung mga powers na yon, major and middle powers, with respect to yung engagement nila sa atin sa Pilipinas. Okay? So ang kagandahan dito, kung titingnan mo, this is supposed to be a security engagement. Okay? But kung titingnan mo yung substance ng commitments, 50% is security and 50% is actually economic in nature. Or a security dialogue. Ha? And that is very surprising. That means there is a recognition that it cannot be yung engagement natin, cannot be all security. Okay? Kailangan merong palaman dyan na economic engagement. Or,
comprehensive strategic. Yeah. Okay?
So if I am to look at yung ano yung pinaka major take natin do take away natin do sa trilateral summit sa Washington DC, that would be yung Luzon Economic Corridor. That would be a major take. Then nakatak in na rin yung civil nuclear energy engagement. Okay, yung chips, yung ano yung sa semiconductor industry, those are add-ons na actually are more important than the security one. Okay? Kasi yung security, ano eh, naiiano natin yan, nakikamada na natin yan, nailatag na natin yan, very robust na yan. Okay. So, yung squad, I think is a new development. But ang nakita ko dito, among the four, among the three, medyo yung commitment between the Philippines and Australia, siguro yun yung medyo titingnan natin na ano, maganda yung ano natin eh yung relationship natin with Australia in terms of bilateral. But in the on the context of yung squad, nung tinitingnan ko yung discussion, it was more of ano eh ang lumalabas sa it was a statement of support and commitment to assist the Philippines with respect to yung South China Sea problem natin, yung concerns natin. So hindi siya kasing substantive nung ano yung trilateral with the US and Japan.
Yung JAFUS, what I call JAFUS.
JAFUS, which you also coined in JAFUS. And yung bilaterals natin, Philippine-US and Philippine-Japan. So there.
Okay. I do agree with you, Admiral, on that point in terms of hindi ito photo op lang, hindi lang for the gram to. A lot of groundwork was there. I mean, ang basa ko rin dito, Admiral, is that it's also kind of a catch-up time, di ba? Kasi ang basa ko dito, kung hindi siguro si Digong ang naging presidente natin, let's say any other naging kandidato nung 2016, any other normal person naging presidente, I think something like squad would have had happened way earlier, no? Whether it's under Trump or Biden.
Well, actually, yung trilateral was already, pinag-uusapan na within the militaries, within the armed forces, even yung time ni former President Duterte pa. But it was something that was under the radar. Alam mo naman, dahil iba yung context na, iba yung focus. So it was something under the radar and there was a quiet conversation on this. Nothing substantive. Kumbaga, basic principles, what
pakiramdaman lang, pakiramdaman lang. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Admiral, going back to this, okay, let's talk, let's go brass tacks. What are we realistically looking at here? Okay, so joint patrols, more joint patrols, quadrilateral patrols in South China Sea, maybe? I mean, more intelligence sharing, but in terms of capacity building, I mean, anong pwedeng concretely na gagawin itong tatlong bansa na yan to make the squad relevant in the context of the disputes we'll discuss later on, especially itong Scarborough, Ayung Inshul. But big picture muna, I mean, what are the things that we can expect from the squad that could... Kasi, let's be honest, Philippines is the weak link, right? Sobrang weakest link tayo. Medyo malayo yung gap eh. I mean, US obviously superpower, but Australia and Japan are full-fledged middle power. The Philippines is still kind of a new-ish middle power, if I can put it charitably. What are the things that we can get out of this? Because if I remember... Lloyd Austin, the U.S. Defense Secretary, said deterrence is something important that they discussed. So in terms of deterrence, anong pwedeng gawin ng tatlo na yan to deter China in terms of its aggression, aggressiveness sa West Philippine Sea?
Okay, siguro low hanging fruit, no? And speaking from a former Navy person, shipbuilding capability, shipbuilding capacity. That is something that we need to work on. And yung foundation sa malang shipbuilding capability, meron na tayo before. But we need infusion of new technology, of course, capital investment. Yung problema natin sa West Philippine Sea ngayon is capacity issue. Eh. And yung capacity is driven by we lack bottoms, or we lack yung ships to match yung ano nila, yung match yung presence ng combined presence ng Navy, Coast Guard, saka Malaysia ng China. Okay, so if we have that, we can work on developing yung domestic shipbuilding capability natin. We can produce sufficient bottoms, at least hindi naman to surpass, but at least yung merong modicum of parity, localized parity, yung ano natin pag nagkatunggal tayo sa dagat.
Now, in terms of
course,
yeah, please.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No, I was wondering, like, in terms of ISR, in terms of some missile systems, ano yung mga pinakamabilis na pwede nila ibigay sa Pilipinas just to a little bit enhance our deterrence capability? Is there something special that Japan or Australia can offer us aside from the United States?
So Japan, I'm not sure, no, kasi ang tinitingnan natin are US systems, eh. Kasi ang issue dito supply chain. Okay? You might let's say acquire the best rifle in the market. Okay? But if yung binili mo yung spare parts niya hindi available locally, then you have to buy it from abroad. So that's a supply chain issue, eh.
Kala ko buy it from Banawe.
buy it from Banawe. But kasi yung supply more or less naka-built in na yung through yung foreign military funding with the US. So meron ng pipeline yon for logistics. So kung titingin tayo sa ibang systems, medyo magkakaproblema tayo sa supply chain.
Now, Admiral, I mean, speaking of capability building, the reason why I'm asking about this is because, again, I'm just playing the devil's advocate here in the sense that baka naman itong squad, it's true na hindi siya for the gram or for photo op lang, pero baka naman it just raises the diplomatic tensions without delivering the goods, right? Baka ang mangyari lang dito, it gives China more excuse to say, oh, tignan nyo, in-encircle kami. Tignan nyo, America, proxy war, I mean, proxy, Pilipinas, tumutulong sa proxy war. Eto, di ba? Eto yung propaganda ng mga makapili. Di ba? Alam naman natin yung kalakaran. Na baka you're just giving propaganda ammunition and more pretext to China to be aggressive without doing what is necessary to actually help us on the ground. Yun yung concern ko dito. I'm not saying that's gonna happen, but I'm saying you have to make sure na you're not creating noise and then hindi mo mapaninindigan yan.
Okay. Number one, we should not believe in our own propaganda. Okay, so let's do our homework. I mean, when we do this, when we do engage them and we have this relationship, merong a roadmap. Ano yung ano mo? Saan papunta yung itong usapan na to? Saan papunta itong engagement na to? Hindi yan pwede yung parang verbal lang na ano, then walang direction. So if you program it or plan it right, I think it will work out. But if yung short-sighted ka, mahihirapan talaga yan. Yung mangyayari, yung sinasabi mo, that would be the scenario na tatahakin natin. And again, kung titingnan natin yung going by yung readouts of yung commitments in the several dialogues na nakita natin over the past year, very solid naman yung usapan doon. Ang ano doon is yung follow-through. Okay, naisulat na. Then meron din tayo responsibility, tayo yung Pilipinas, to also capacitate ourselves para i-absorb lahat yung commitments na yun. Otherwise, kahit ibuhos sa'yo yung supportang yun, tapos hindi ka prepared to absorb that type of support, magdi-dissipate din yun.
What are the areas, and this is where, again, amateurs talk, and geopolitics, experts talk to logistics, no? Are there something specific that you have in mind in terms of certain supply chains, in terms of defense acquisitions from the other Quad countries?
Okay, let's say, for example, pabalik tayo sa barko.
Right. Let's talk Russia. Yeah.
So, Okay, yung tin-transfer sa atin yung Hamilton class yung cutter from the US Coast Guard. You have to set up yung ecosystem to support yung logistics at yung maintenance ecosystem to support that. Okay? So we prepared, the Navy prepared itself, pati yung tao that will do the maintenance and yung financial requirements para i-support yung ano na yun, activity na yun. Para pagka merong maintenance site, yung papasok sa maintenance cycle, kaya na-perform dito ng Navy, ng organization. Now, kung wala yun, that ship will deteriorate. Kasi wala kang wala kang set up na system to sustain it eh. Remember, para kang bumili ng kotse, 'di ba, may tech manual 'yan eh. Tapos tatawagan ka nung dealer every 6 months reminding you na mayroon kang progressive maintenance to follow. Now, kung wala yung system na 'yon, even if yung kotse mo bago, in 1 year's time, that will deteriorate if you do not follow the maintenance cycle. So that ecosystem is also transferable kung co-contextualize mo sa isang sa weapon system din.
Thank you for that, Admiral. Again, I mean, it's common sense, right? You're not going to buy a Ferrari kung wala kang pang maintenance and make sure my service center and all, right? This is the logic. Now, do you think that we're moving in the direction of creating that ecosystem? Let's say, I don't want to use the word industrial military complex. That would be a little bit too ambitious, pretentious. But is there any move in that regards from the JAFUS meeting, from the squad, from some of the statements coming out of DND, from the information you have? Meron ba tayong encouraging move on that front? Because I remember in the previous conversation, tinanong ko si Jay, and this is what I always ask my guests, no? Nakakulang ba ang Amerika sa atin? I mean, they just gave 17 billion to Israel, 60 billion to Ukraine. They have been giving billions to Jordan, Pakistan, those kinds of countries na hindi naman nila ally or nowhere as close to the US. And then, of course, people always say, but ang problema ng Pilipinas, back in the day, we had shiny American weapons, di naman natin na-maintain. This is, I don't know, 60s, 70s, whatever. So are things changing in the right direction if we are moving towards getting more and more advanced weapon systems from our key allies?
Okay, nakita ko rito yung part of the ecosystem that we need to prepare is yung defense industry natin. Okay. Kasi hindi pwedeng armed forces or the Department of Defense lang eh. There are some things that the private sector is more efficient in performing, okay? And papasok yan doon sa defense industry na and I think yung batas para doon still under development eh, still under deliberation, so once matapos yun, I think then we have capacitated ourselves in terms of yung legal.
Hindi ba nakapasa tayo nung yung procurement law the other year? Hindi pa tapos na yan, Admiral? Para 2022
procurement,
pa? Enlighten
procurement.
Me.
Different. Okay, procurement. Ganito yan eh. Under the current setup kasi natin, it is biased against a domestic industry.
Industry, yeah. More important.
Okay, yung specification ng AFP modernization law, you have to have 3 other countries actually using a system na you're trying to acquire. So obviously, yes. Tanggal ka agad yung domestic mo na proponent. Kasi wala, it doesn't exist yet eh. Okay? So yung bias na yun should be corrected. Kasi we can look at yung low-end type of equipment na pwedeng support ng future domestic industry natin.
I mean, all you have to do is, diba, to put except in conditions where you want to develop the weapon system yourself. Diba, dagdagan mo lang. Kasi gets ko naman sinasabi na tatlong countries kasi you want to make sure you don't buy mumbo-jumbo weapon systems. I don't know from, I don't know, Siberia or whatever, right? Pero dadagdagan mo lang dyan, except in situation when you want to develop it. Of course, infant industry, and you cannot assure the market kaagad of tatlong countries. So I mean, I wonder what the heck were our lawyers doing and people who were involved in this AFP modernization laws and all of that. I mean, these are pretty common sense, diba? Kasi I remember I was discussing with a number of defense experts how, for instance, Korea, India, Turkey, even Pakistan, diba? Yung mga ganong countries, they're developing their defense industries na eh. Brazil. Kaya naman natin kung kaya ng mga ganitong developing countries. Indonesia, diba? Why not the Philippines? So medyo nagtataka ako, bakit ang dami mga gaps sa ating batas? Why is it so discouraging to developing a domestic industry, defense industry?
Kasi I think it should be a careful, a very close collaboration between private sector at government. No? You mentioned about Indonesia. Supported nila yung defense industry nila. I mean, South Korea na lang, yun ang gold standard niya. Eh. South Korea. Okay. That was a collaboration between government and private sector to develop that industry. Japan, ganun din. So if hindi natin, if government doesn't recognize that that type of industry as a future at all, then hindi siya magano, hindi siya magi-startup. So basically it takes two to tango, kumbaga, government and private sector.
Okay, Admiral, bago tayo ma-depress kasi medyo sa minsan yeah. Mapapakamot ako ng ulo. Ang daming hindi inisip. So for instance, we're talking about ICC, yung withdrawal ni Digong. There's no law about withdrawal from a treaty. So I was talking to Senator Gatchalian also about this. Parang, anong klaseng bansa yan? Hindi nila naisip yung mga contingencies na yan. But never mind. Okay. Eto, balikatan. Balikan natin ang balikatan. So as we speak, the balikatan is reaching its twilight moments. But huge things have been happening. Itong C-Star missile system na ginamit ng BRP Rizal, sinking vessel drills, yung deployment ng Typhoon, although hindi naman ginamit ng US. HIMARS was once again featured in these exercises. Not to mention, of course, geography, very important. First exercises in the exclusive economic zone outside the territorial sea. French were involved. And then there were exercises in Cagayan. Now, let's talk about Balikatan first. What is your understanding of the weapon systems that were deployed and the location of these exercises? And the relevance, obviously.
Okay. Balikatan has two components or has two aspects to it. Eh. Number one would be yung looking at readiness. And that's through training, tsaka yung familiarization with the equipment that's used or the system that's used. The second one is it's a signaling tool. Okay, when I say signaling, it's one way of communicating to yung target audience, in this case, yung neighbor natin to the north, about our resolve or our intentions. Hopefully, that creates the deterrence effect na we aspire for. So yun yung dalawang aspeto ng exercise, particularly dito sa Balikatan exercise. So nakita natin, number one, there are several systems na ginamit o in-testing or in-exercise for the first time. Okay, particularly, siguro, yung highlight na would be yung sinking exercise o yung SINCEX in Northern Philippines. Okay? And that was the first time na na-test yung missile, yung anti-ship missile system natin. Yung
one of our star. Yeah.
So, that creates confidence in the organization. I mean, kaya natin to. And ang importanting part dito na in exercise na actually, yung tinatawag nating kill chain. Okay, yung kill chain system. That's the one that links yung target acquisition, yung fixing the target and linking the shooter, in this case the one that shoots the missile to the target. So that requires a system na mag-integrate yung ISR mo o yung surveillance systems mo with your weapon system. Okay? So yun yung pinaka-importanting na i-test in this type of exercise. Okay? The other one naman yung mga land exercises
yung HIMARS. HIMARS yung ginamit.
Yeah, yung HIMARS it's basically the HIMARS is not something new. Kumbaga, nagamit yan previously. So it's building on previous experience with the use of the HIMARS. Yung HIMARS is very important kasi I think the Armed Forces is looking at it as a complementary system to the BrahMos anti-ship missile system. Okay, kasi the BrahMos is a for long range, 290 kilometers yung range niya. But you also need a shorter range weapon. In this case, that would be the HIMARS. If the armed forces so decides to acquire that.
So multi-layered parang onion cabbage style, di ba? Oo.
Kasi if we have the HIMARS, I would deploy it sa ating slots, yung ating archipelago strikes. For example, sa Zone Strait, dun sa may northern
part. Mabulis.
Not Mabulis. Kasi maliit yun eh. Wala
talaga. Hindi kaya. Masyadong malaki. Kaya, Batanes or kaya
Cagayan, yeah. yung sa Mindoro, and of course sa Palawan. So those are areas affected by HIMARS. The BrahMos is directed towards kasi outer layer na yan, papunta sa exclusive economic zone. So that creates yung tinatawag nating buffer between yung ating kalupaan, yung ating baseline, and yung extent ng yung pinaka maximum effective range ng missile system. In this case is 290 kilometers.
And what about the French? The exercises for the first time outside the territorial sea at kasama pa yung mga French. Although alam ko medyo may konting plausible deniability the French participation, but that was the first time the French were involved, right? And obviously the French want to push for a reciprocal access agreement. Gusto tayong bentahan ng submarine. So medyo hot ang mga French sa atin ngayon, di ba?
I think yung sa French naman, it's consistent with yung Indo-PACOM kasi may sarili naman silang Indo-PACOM strategy. And they're moving towards increased presence. But of course, within the area, alam ko, isa lang naman talaga yung ano nila, yung isa lang yung pinaka-major surface combatant nila na nagpapatrol. And that was the vessel that participated in Balikatan exercise. Also, they're also affected by yung projection ng China outward towards the Pacific. Remember, the French has territorial territories in the Southern Pacific na binabantayan din nila. So they are also affected by what the developments dito sa Solomon Islands, dito sa may Mid-Pacific, na merong increased presence ng Chinese influence already. Okay.
Now, when it comes to Balikatan, do you think this is the new normal that we're going to see more and more massive exercises and more advances? I mean, and by the way, yung Typhoon, what was the story about that? Ano ba talaga, dinaan lang dito? Nagpa-cute lang yung Typhoon missile system ng US, ay launcher, sorry. What was the drama about that?
Okay, mas remember, yung Typhoon missile is a sort of a, parang yan yung ano nila, anti-access, anti-area denial system ng US Army. Okay. Now, nakatuck-in kasi in all Balikatan exercises, yung logistics component ng exercise ng US. Kasi moving troops and moving equipment from point A to point B, with point B being the Philippines, that takes a lot of planning. Okay? Particularly if you are moving more than let's say 10,000 or 15,000 troops at any given time.
Right.
And yung associated equipment doon. So yung logistics planning mo ron is complex and deliberate. Okay? So moving that Typhoon missile from wherever they came from, papunta sa Pilipinas, that is in itself is already an exercise. You don't have to actually shoot it. Pangalawa, the US Army is exercising actually a new concept or a new doctrine nila, yung forward deployment. Yung US Army nila is trying to be relevant sa Pacific. Okay, that is one of the challenges nila na inano nila. Kasi basically, the Pacific theater of operations is a US Navy, US Marine Corps lake or area yan. Yung US Army sa plays a secondary role. So I think this is one way of them creating the relevance, okay? Dun sa ano. Now on the Typhoon missile system itself. To me that is a very important system. Kasi
Paki-explain, what was the missile? Why is it so important? Parang 2 years ago lang na-develop yan at saka first time na-deploy sa Indo-Pacific yan, di ba? Medyo bago-bago to, di ba?
Ito yung situation natin. The entire Philippine archipelago is within the umbrella coverage ng A2AD capability ng China. That means, in theory, it can hit us anywhere within the archipelago. And we do not have a defense system to address that potential problem in the future. So yung Typhoon missile system actually is a defensive system that would address yung gap na yon. We don't have the resources to buy or to develop this capability. And I think this is something in my quiet conversation doon sa mga active service pa. You have to keep this in the conversation with our US ally kasi this is a gap and it renders all our forces vulnerable within the entire Philippines. So we need a defense system. So the Typhoon missile system actually would address that gap for me. Okay.
And in terms of the participation of what about other countries, Japan, Australia, and then ang daming inimbita this year, di ba? Marami from the ASEAN countries. And China, bakit andun yung China? Is it to remind them of what we have? Is it part of the deterrence effect? Kasi may Chinese observer, di ba?
I think yung actual participants doon are ano eh, yung US tsaka Philippines lang. The rest are technically observers doon sa ano. And yung participation nila is very minimal, particularly on the land exercises. Yung naval exercises pwede 'yon kasi yung barko kasi extension ng territory niya, nila yan eh wherever they go. So wala tayong problema masyado for naval exercises. But if you notice, yung sa land exercises natin, very very constrained or very limited yung participation ng other troops. Except maybe for Australia kasi may sompa tayo sa kanila. Okay. So that's why yung Japan is we're looking at yung access arrangement with them para ma-increase nila yung footprint nila or yung participation nila in future exercises. And most likely, ganun din yung sa French. That's why they may be studying or actually looking at yung access arrangement also because they also want to increase yung participation nila. That beyond yung observer role.
Right. Now, pag-usapan natin itong latest, itong latter part of yung kumbaga, I think in a lawyerly we set the predicate. All right, medyo mahaba-haba. Ngayon, pag-usapan natin, ito nangyari ngayon sa Ayungin Shoal and Scarborough Shoal. Before we go to the more speculative part, gusto ko lang tanungin bilang isang former admiral sa Philippine Navy, how do you feel about the situation na parang in-injure na tayo? Parang itsura natin, parang kawawa na. I mean, again, I know we don't want to second guess what's the strategy of the government. My sense is obviously China is coming up as out as a bully here. It's a diplomatic damage to them. But 'di ba gusto natin maging David eh? Hindi, 'di ba? And David mas maliit siya kay Goliath, pero macho siya, magaling siya, gwapo siya, 'di ba? I mean, how do you become David without being kawawa? Okay, I mean, what is the right balance there? Kasi parang kinakawawa tayo. Ba't tayo gumagamit ng mga lumang mga boats, di ba? Of course, I asked this question to active personnel like Commodore Trinidad, but I want to take your view as someone who's a retired member of the Philippine Navy. How do you see this and what do you think is the way forward? Or should we just trust the wisdom of the government?
I go Richard kasi I will go back to ano yung ROE na nilatag natin sa sarili natin. And I will go back to yung tactics mo on the ground, tactics mo at sea is only limited by your imagination eh. Okay. So if you constrain yourself, you put guardrails into your responses. Of course, yun yung pupuntahan natin, yung mukha tayong kawawa. Of course, at the back of our mind, we're also worried about yung potential escalation ng hibaan natin, no? So ano yung proper calibrated response? I think I mentioned to you
What's
about yung ano
the
eh.
Goldilocks approach? Goldilocks, let's put it that
The
way. Yeah.
call. Okay. Alam mo, I sometimes use the analogy ng basketball, no? Oftentimes, no? So dito, if you play basketball in the West Philippine Sea, and yung katunggali mo is medyo aggressive yung ano niya, nakikipagbalyahan, nakikipagsanggaan, nang sasahod, okay? Tapos ikaw, yung coach mo, kinonstrain ka, sabi, we are nice guys, we don't play rough.
Disente
So,
tayo, disente.
si ang mangyari yan, magiging gymnastics yan, para ikang lilipad sa ere dahil pag sinahod ka na o binalya ka na, you're all over the place. Okay? So, to me, it's a matter of rules of engagement. Eh. Immaterial lang kung malaking barko ka o maliit na barko ka. It's how you respond. Eh. How you, ano eh. We are not deterring them kasi walang cost. Eh. Okay, when utter cannon ka, walang cost sa kanila yon. Sa kanila physically. Of course, reputation-wise, sa public opinion space in terms of yung information war, doon yung cost sa kanila. Pero on at sea, walang physical cost sa kanila yon. Kaya, kumbaga, sa kanila, okay, ano to? So far, okay, so good tayo. Tuloy-tuloy lang yung water cannon nila, tsaka yung calibrated collision nila sa atin. And I mentioned this, I think, before, na since last December, I call it mission kill tactics, no? They've started targeting yung ano eh, yung communication system, radar system, or yung sense, yung bridge, yung pinaka control ng barko. This is not to actually sink yung barko natin, but actually to render it incapacitated in such a way na sa next sortie hindi mo na magamit kasi kailangan mo pa repair eh. Okay?
I see. Yeah. So parang yeah, I mean, you're right. I mean, ipaparalyze mo essentially yung mga ganitong mga resupply capacity, 'di ba? I mean, yeah. It's the status quo sustainable. You know, every other day magpaano tayo, magpa-damage tayo, magpa-injure tayo. Parang I'm not sure how sustainable this is. I mean, I see the PR in terms of making sure that the world knows na bully ang China, which I think everyone knows by this time already. I mean, how much more reminder do we need? But I don't know. I mean, sustainable ba ito? Ano ba talaga nangyari?
Kasi at some point, yung first five mo, pag pinayaan mo mabalya, eventually, bibench mo na yung first five mo. Mabuti kung may second five ka o may third five ka, eh paano kung wala? And sila, malalim yung bench nila. Oh,
so buong liga yung bench nila, 'di ba? Armada sila eh.
Pati nga yung ano eh, pati yung cheering squad tsaka yung coach nila nandoon sa basketball court. So it's a be ang point ko. It's at a war of attrition 'yan eh. At some point mauubusan ka ng resources doon sa ano eh because mini mission kill nila yung barko mo eh.
So in a way, hindi masyadong bobo yung strategy ng China, if I can put it that way, na in a way they are paying a PR cost now, but down the road they may actually significantly degrade our capability to sustain these kinds of resupply missions. Now, moving forward, Admiral, again, I maybe disagree with me, but the point is, should we do also our kind of reverse cabbage strategy, like when you Philippine Coast Guard and then around it put Philippine Navy, right, or something like that, right? And I don't know. Should we also do our own versions of that, even though limitado yung capability natin? I mean, what are we looking at here? Instead of mga kahoy-kahoy na boat na ito na private tong iba, di ba? Ginagamit ng Philippine Navy, hindi naman Navy mismo, di ba?
Well, they are crewed by the Navy. So, technically, Navy sila. But the reason why ginagamit yung ano yung Unai Salmi is hindi because yung kahoy siya, but yung ano niya, yung draft niya. Kasi yung papagpasok mo ng Ayuming Shoal, malalim, mababaw yun eh. So you need a vessel with the capacity pakapasok doon na hindi siya magra-run aground. So yun that's basically the reason, no? I presume that the Navy had an alternative platform na bakal. Yun ang gagamitin nila. Okay? But of course that already changes yung pagkakaano kasi natin na it has to be a civilian vessel or civilian like vessel. That in itself is constraining us to a certain course of action in which in this case is yung Unai sa may boats ang ginagamit natin. Kumbaga kinahuna natin yung sarili natin doon sa ganung type of tactic. Eh basang-basa na lang China yun eh. Kumbaga kahit natutulog sila
yun nga,
alam na gagawin nila eh.
Exactly, yun nga eh. So, yun nga, like I think that's why I ask, is this sustainable? Kasi we're incurring injuries. God forbid, I know China is still using water cannons pa, but I was told na dalawang Mike Tyson yan or something like that. If I mean, I said, paki-translate yung power yung water cannon into punching power. Parang sinabi nung isa, it's like a combination of Pacquiao and Tyson or something like that. I mean, you can kill a person with that kind of punching power. So, are we waiting for disaster here? I mean, what's going on here?
Basically, Richard, we need to rethink tactics. Okay? Yung tactics kasi is driven by maraming factors eh. Kung simple lang sana yung pag-ano nun, kasi may politics involved eh. Meron yung escalation issue involved eh. So, yun yung nag-define kung ano yung pwede mong gawin. Tsaka hindi mo pwedeng gawin. Pero siguro ang pinaka-benchmark ko rito ay go back to yung Cod War, yung COD, Cod War between United Kingdom tsaka Iceland. That was in the 60s and 70s. Wala pang UNCLOS noon. Okay? And wala pang concept ng exclusive economic zone. Iceland was trying to protect yung kumbaga yung ano niya, yung area niya, and yung United Kingdom, being the United Kingdom, was the dominant force doon sa area doon sa North Sea. Okay? But Iceland won that war. Okay? And it using only civilian tugboats.
I didn't know this Iceland case study. Have you written something on this, Admiral, or you just came across it this time? Hindi natin ang pag-usapan.
I always go back.
Vikings yan eh.
That was in the 60s and 70s. I was, yun yung ano eh, yun, try mo yung ano.
Yung I haven't heard about, this is the first time, I'll be honest. Like, wow, that's interesting. Baka Vikings gusto kailangan natin. Baka mga Badjao, padala natin mga Badjao at Moro Brothers natin. Pwede ba yan?
Alam mo yung lumabas doon sa ano when yung study na yon. Ang pinaka winning ang winning factor doon national will. It was not the tactics, it was not the type of vessel that was used kasi ang kalaban nila doon mga British warship eh. Okay? It was national will yung nag ano kaya nanalo yung Iceland doon. They fought for yung interest nila.
Pero yun nga, I'm sure may natural will yan kasi mga Vikings yan. Ito na naman tayo. Pamak na naman ako. Lastly, Admiral, I mean, as we speak right now, there's an open call to expel the Chinese ambassador from the Philippines. And ako, actually, we had a talk with the Ronald Liamas just a few days ago na kailangan ba expel yung ambassador. So it's there on my YouTube. You can check it. So na-anticipate natin itong direction of the wind. What is your read of what's going on with China? Itong mga special temporary arrangement, new model, whatever. Again, I know it's a bit speculative, but in terms of big picture, do you think China is kind of panic mode, scrambling? Medyo they're running out of ideas. What's your again surface level read? Because I think none of us have a direct information confidential on this, or if we had, we won't share.
Okay, siguro number one, and you know naman, I give lectures on political warfare, no? It proves the point that embassies and consulates are actually operating in terms of United Front Work activities, okay? Kasi yung ginagawa niya, that those are not typical activities of an ordinary embassy. Those are United Front Work activities. So, disinformation, propaganda,
makapili corporation.
Yeah, yung cooptation of political or key decision makers within yung country that you are deployed in. Those are classic United Front Work activities. So outright they are already violating yung ano eh
sovereignty natin. Oh.
Kung titingnan natin within yung international rules that govern how embassies and consulates should operate, they are violating it. Upfront eh. So tama lang naman yung call for ano yung i-consider yung persona ng grata certain personalities doon sa embassy kasi they're actually going overboard doon sa ano
so this is like the Soviet Union before, di ba, na biglang pa-expel yung ambassador ganun kasi na find out na puro palang KGB yung mga nandun, di ba? Yung mga, I mean, you understand there are gonna be intelligence and defense officers pero hindi yung all out na, I mean, what do you think about this crazy situation? My mayor dyan sa Tarlac na wala tayong birth certificate until 17 years old siya. And then, I mean, Chinese yung father, may pogo operations. I mean, this is insane. Baka they're all related, no? I mean, again, this is, I know this, Di Umanoy. I mean, this looks like something crazy is going on in the Philippines over the past few years.
Actually, it's related, Richard. I recall nung ano, after the Scarborough Shoal standoff, we ran a assessment around 2013. Okay. And lumabas sa assessment namin that if we have a problem with China in the future, and that was 2013, it's not going to be something like meron kang makikitang Chinese or PLA Marines invading an isolated island. Okay. Ang magpapanagpo tayo within our own bureaucracy. Doon ang arena of conflict. The reason being, number one, we are a democratic country, so inherently open tayo. Pangalawa, we do not have perfect bureaucracies. And you know what I mean. Yung yung issue related dun sa mayor sa Bamban would be looking at yung operations ng civil registrars natin in terms of fidelity in integrity in the way they perform their role or their task as part of the bureaucracy. Meron pa yung ano, hindi pa natin kinoconsider yung sa real estate. Okay? Kasi anecdota lang because we cannot prove. But yung ano, yung the possibility of Filipinos being used by Chinese interests as dummies in buying real estate properties around military camps. And that is a factor of yung may butas yung bureaucracy natin in terms of actually yung implementation of yung real estate regulations natin. So hindi lang yung ano, hindi lang yun yung mayor, baka we find ourselves baka yung mga major camps natin. And this is happening in the United States, ha? Hindi ano to. I think that was in Texas, yung Air Force Base nila, yung property around it was bought by a third party. So pwede yun.
Yeah, so mukhang, again, of course, Admiral Long, we want to make sure na we don't get into kind of xenophobic, prejudicial discussion and all, pero hindi naman tayo na pwede na, you know, mang-mang lang, di ba? I mean, so I talked to Senator Gatchalian, was it Chinoy himself, right? He openly says, ito mga pogo na to, dapat i-ban eh, na talagang ano to eh. This is like a gangrene, right? It's eating into our bureaucracy, umabot ang pera kung saan-saan, hanggang ngayon, hindi nila masarasara, hindi nila maalam na saan papunta ito. So that means the enemy is within the gates, right? Like, so do we need like a sweeping response? I mean, literally sweep. I mean, looks like medyo compromised na tayo because of the Duterte legacy.
No, I in fairness naman, it's not because of former President Duterte lang, kasi I think it was ongoing before pa. Kasi these are systems.
No, but the pogos came in big time during Digong.
Ah, yeah, the pogo, yes. But what I mean is, there are already, even before him, there are already systemic gaps or loopholes within yung bureaucracy natin that needs to be plugged. Okay? So, kumaga, nagkaroon tayo ng perfect storm nung previous 6 years. Okay? Meron ka ng gaps, then yung environment, the political environment is conducive to ano, actually accentuating yung loopholes na yun.
I know you're trying to avoid to get a little bit too speculative, but unfortunately, ito pa yung mga gustong-gusto ng tao. Ito yung mga speculative part. So don't worry, I'm gonna bring back si Ronald Diamas to discuss this part kasi siya yung ano eh, fireworks ka agad. But again, no surprise, right? We saw this disaster coming. We have been warning about this for a long time. At ngayon, mukhang medyo may moment of reckoning tayo. And as I said, as we speak, there's a call for expulsion of the Chinese ambassador for, among others, engaging in disinformation activities. And as you put it politely, for breaching the normal jurisdiction of what an embassy should do in another country. Mukhang medyo next level na ito nangyari. So I think this also brings home itong analogy of the Philippines kind of being the Vienna / Berlin, right? I mean, this is where the new Cold War is happening, right? I mean, we know for a fact the Americans are here, a lot of them, right? So it looks like the Chinese part have stepped up their game also. At hindi ito Marites lang.
We are the ano eh, we are the Casablanca of Southeast Asia.
That's sexier. Yeah, Casablanca. I'm sure they would love it. Yeah. I wanted to say Havana kasi Havana naging communist na. So let's not get there. Yeah, I think Casablanca is also another way of putting it, although with a slightly different historical reference. But that's a good suggestion. The Vienna and Berlin is a bit too cold. That's a reference point for Manila nowadays. Admiral Ol, thank you so much. I wanted to ask more Marites of you, but sabi ko parang ilang ka na yata. So I will pull in someone else to discuss this. But thank you so much, Admiral. Is there something else you want to add on this issue in general in terms of moving forward in AFP modernization, Navy? What are the things that we have to keep in mind? Ano yung mga checklist natin na we have to deal with in the coming years?
I think, Richard, hindi ko nasagot yung question mo on the gentleman's agreement. No?
Ayaw nga pala, sorry. Please, go ahead.
Siguro, ano, hindi naman to, ano eh, hindi to bago, no? Even before, decades ago, that has been always yung practice nila. They'll try to, pag nagka-problema sa dagat, at least for the Navy experience, no? they will always call you up and ask for they ask you what happened and ang practice kasi namin noon and I'm not sure kung yun pa rin ang practice namin ang humaharap lang sa kanila are ano eh intelligence officers or intelligence staff the reason why is ano trained yun eh to, para makipag-deal sa kanila
right
okay and almost all engagement or conversation with them recorded yun. Okay, recorded
by
yun.
Both sides. By both sides. Oh, para sigurado.
Hindi, sa side, sa atin. Ang tawag namin yung contact report eh. When you submit that to higher headquarters, okay, I met so they went to my office, we discussed this. Okay, so naka-report yun. That is yung protection ng organization saka yung protection ng kausap nila. Everything's above board. Okay. Now, the reason why, if you remember, I think during the former administration, there was an attempt to, ano, remember na kaset up sila ng hotline with the Coast Guard. Okay. And they were trying to replicate that with the armed forces. In fact, they want a hotline with NOLCOM saka a hotline with WESCOM, which we objected to. Precisely because ang gagawin nila, dediretso sila dun sa operational commander. Pag may problema sa West PP.
Alam na this.
Kaya ni-reject yun. Kasi ang naging compromise doon, it should be with the Department of Foreign Affairs yung hotline. Not even DND. Okay? Kasi nga to protect the organization.
I see what you're saying. Oh.
So if we breach that protection mechanisms, of course, magiging vulnerable tayo. Kung saan.
Yeah, that's a very good point. So what do you think about itong audio daw i-release nila ito? Compromat ba ito? Deep fake ba ito? I mean, there are open warnings about deep fakes being used to sow confusion. Kasi ako, Admiral, ang basa ko dito is, obviously mukhang ewan sila to much of the world with what they're doing. But my hunch is, this will allow other ASEAN countries na medyo pro-China or ayaw tumulong sa ato sabihin, oh, see, yung pala eh, kayo pala mga Pinay ang magulo eh. Ito ah, ito, eh. Tama naman yung sinabi ng Odi, yung pala nangako kayo, kayong pampagulo. You get what I'm saying? Like, it gives excuse for others to remain neutral or take China's side. So, nakikita ko may value din sa China yan eh, to gaslight us and come up with this confusion and disinformation.
I will interpret it sa parang ano political blackmail. Okay? Kasi may escalation siya eh. Diba? Parang striptease eh. Meron akong ganito. Okay.
Pero blackmail mo, sino ma-compromise dyan? I mean, if it's current officials, you are actually creating a backfire, right? Lalo sila maging aggressive against you. If it's an ex-official, pinahamak mo pa yung asset mo, di ba? I mean...
Depende sa ano eh. Kasi they can make a mistake eh. Kasi ang problema nila, I think they misread us eh. They don't understand how a Filipino mind operates eh. Kasi kung ano, maaring ang tawag namin diyan sa military ano eh, mirror imaging eh. Yung ano, when you project your own biases.
They project themselves. Yeah, yeah. The other party, like China, exactly.
So they would be projecting, okay, if I were them, I will think this way and I will act this way. And we're not acting that way. That confuses them. Okay? So dito, siguro, nakita nila, ang calibration nila dito, okay, I will gradually parang ano, escalate. Okay? Hoping, by, siguro sa calculation nila, bibigay tayo. Kasi rather than suffer yung quote-unquote exposure of that ano yun, parang deep throat, no? Sa ano, yung ano, yung that so-called tape, no?
Yun nga,
whether that, yeah.
This is like mafia stuff. I mean, this is like, KGB, I mean, sabi nga ni ano, di ba, General Anyo, pathetic na ito. This is like embarrassing. This is pathetic. I mean, anong gusto nila ma-achieve dito? Kaya nga, the only thing I can think about is, papogi sila sa, I don't know, Cambodia of this world and say, see, mga Pilipino ang pampagulo, di ba? Kasi yun yung narrative nila eh, na tayo ang nag, but everyone is denying it and nag, kasi umabot na sa isang sitwasyon kung saan, ay, sa tingin ko, wala nang official na gusto makipag-usap sa kanila kasi you don't feel safe eh. They will just make up stories, di ba? Papahamak ka lang nila eh. So, huwag na tayo mag-usap.
I think the word siguro is desperate. Kumaka, they're trying to get a handle of they're trying to get a handle of the situation. Particularly yung ano, yung propaganda war natin. They're trying to get a handle of it. And kumbaga retake yung ano, yung na, kasi we're now tayo yung nagdidictate na narrative na yun. Before sila, we are able to wrest it away from them. So I think it's them trying to recover yung ano, yung control of the narrative. And because of that, it creates, kumbaga, for them, parang mga, ano eh, sa akin, major mistake na yan. Eh, yung ginagawa nila. Eh. And it actually exposes yung kanilang, ano, yung non-diplomatic activities nila sa embassy.
Exactly. I mean, for me, I'm sure this is just a coincidence, pero parang it looks as desperate as yung People Power BBM resign rally ng mga kaibigan natin dyan, ano. I mean, it all reeks of desperation mode, diba? And I mean, this is ridiculous. But what do you think is the best course of action for the Marcos administration? Is it just to allow the Chinese to, I mean, should we be Napoleon and say, if your enemy is making mistake, just let them, you know, essentially choke on their own mistake, you know, fall on their own sword? Or baka nakakatakot na ito, na baka kung naging cornered beast tong mga to, whether it's China or their assets here, baka they'll do something very stupid. I mean, aren't we worried about it? I heard in China some are saying, it's time to show the sword, yung expression na ganun. Again, I don't want to fearmonger kasi gawain na makapili yan. But at the same time, I don't want to be too complacent. So again, what's the Goldilocks approach here, Admiral?
You have to understand ano yung objective nila eh, muna, before you can make a response. And I go by yung discussions yun ni Secretary Ronald eh, about yung nagkakaroon kasi ng convergence yung ating problems sa West Philippine Sea. Tsaka yung domestic political problems natin, nagkakaroon na ng convergence eh. Siguro parang ang I would say, for want of a better word, parang nagkakaroon ng, you can already sense yung parang unholy alliance between the two parties na eh. Okay. Now, if I were in their shoes, if I were in the shoes ng China, and I look at yung, ano yung, what's creating, what is the one thing that creates problems for me, it's the president. Kasi siya yung driver ng foreign policy natin, tsaka national security natin. And obviously, I need to look at how do I now influence the president to shift or at least to recalibrate or revise yung kanyang current posture. So yun yung ano eh, yun yung direction nun eh, na nakita ko.
Right. I mean, as I always said to Secretary Llamas, you never know who's listening to us sa mga marites namin. But it's happening, right? This is what I and Ronald have been discussing for the past year na makakaalaman na talaga. Nagdamay-damay na to eh. Damay-damay na eh.
Kasi ano, ang ano natin, again, I go back to yung kinuwento ko kanina about yung ginawa namin assessment on 2013. When we look at yung sistema natin, the way we operate sa Pilipinas, ang tinatawag natin center of gravity, ang center of gravity natin yung presidency. Not the president as a person ha, but the presidency as yung entire mechanism of government that revolves around the presidency. Yun yung center of gravity natin. And of course, being the center of gravity, yun din yung focus ng any ano type of political attacks sa ating ano. Kasi pag nakuha mo yon or natibag mo yon, guguho yung entire natin eh, policy making mechanism eh, yung ating ano ng government natin.
I know, medyo I think we're reaching a moment of truth as we speak. Medyo grabe ito. Kaya ako, I mean, I know, you know, Admiral, I mean, ako nag-start ako sa West Philippine Sea issue and all, di ba? And ngayon, wala na. Talagang everyday marites na ako kasi there's no way to appreciate foreign policy if you're not looking at also what's happening inside the Philippines. This is the crazy situation. Thank you so much again, Admiral, for joining us, Admiral Ong. Again, I'm sure babalikan kita in soon, God willing, inshallah, to discuss more itong mga West Philippine Sea developments. But for now, thank you so much, Admiral. Just to end on this, maybe I'm trying something different like Ezra Klein style. Do you have any recommendations of what should people read from your works or anyone's work na sa tingin mo helps them better understand itong predicament ng Philippines at anong mga kailangan natin gawin sa West Philippines. Are there like two or three articles or books that you suggest for our viewers?
Not from...
Including
not
yours.
Not from my own work, no? Siguro I mentioned kanina, and maybe you may try it after this session natin. Try to Google or research on the United Kingdom versus Ireland Cod War. Kasi that is parang reflective of yung situation natin ngayon. You have a small power versus a major power trying to battle it out in a contested maritime space. And you have a small power winning it out. How did they do that? Siguro, that could be yung lesson natin.
Thank you so much for that, Admiral. Are there any articles of yours that you recommend, in recent articles that people can check?
Siguro, it's in Rappler naman eh. I have previous articles on the West Philippine Sea, tapos on the trilateral.
Trilateral, tsaka yung asymmetric. Kasi one thing I appreciate about is yung discussion natin, let's learn something from Ukraine or, I don't know, even Houthis, no? How they use drones and other things to equalize the field, no, with much more powerful and advanced countries. Pwede rin natin gamitin yan. So thank you so much again, Admiral, and talk to you soon. Mabuhay po kayo.
Okay, thank you, Richard.
Pleasure.